want to thank the organizers so much for doing this and for giving me a chance to talk about my work, but more importantly, for giving us here at CU a chance to think of ourselves as a community of DH practitioners. It's really been a remarkable 5 years for me at CU, and over those 5 years, I've really come to feel like I'm part of a community of people who practice DH across a wide variety of departments and schools and colleges and programs. And it's been very stimulating and gratifying. So my job today is just to talk about the work that I do. There's something of an implicit argument, and that is that media archaeology, which is what I'm focusing on nowadays, is a digital humanities practice, but I don't spend a lot of time explicitly talking about that. So I'm just going to start with the straightest scholarship that I do. Which is just an encyclopedia. It's super straight. So I've been, over the past 2 or 3 years, working on editing the Johns Hopkins Guide to Digital Media with Marie-Laura Ryan and Ben Robertson, which will be published in the spring. Incredibly, I don't think this sort of resource exists yet at all. I'm not sure why. Interestingly enough, or not, we spent several months actually debating amongst ourselves and debating with Johns Hopkins Press about whether to call it a guidebook to digital humanities or digital media. Me personally, I didn't feel equipped to wade into the debates about digital humanities to handle that. But I also think that the term digital media provides a nice way of framing the entries that we solicited, entries that have a very strong historical dimension. So we have a lot of entries on the history of gaming, history of computing, history of electronic literature, and digital art. So our collection, I think, builds a nice bridge between the past and the present, so that the field of digital media isn't purely a presentist field of study. And I think we're finding, too, that as history starts to accumulate and as the preservation of digital artifacts become more and more of a concern, older practices and technologies are attracting more and more scholarly attention. And sort of symptomatic of that trend is the emergence of media archaeology, which seems to be really gathering ground in terms of a popular field of study. So media archaeology, that leads nicely into my other somewhat less straight, but still straight, other project. This is my monograph book project that will be published in spring, and it's called Reading Writing Interfaces from the Digital to the Bookbound. I think the only non-straight part of it is that it starts from the present and works its way backwards. It begins and ends with magic. This is something that I'm becoming more and more interested in. So from the stylized David Copperfield-inspired Apple launches for iPads, which are usually touted as truly magical and revolutionary products, that's a direct quote, to the impending launch of Google Glass, which is already being marketed as a device that will provide answers without having to ask, we are well into the era of the marvelous. Marvelous in the sense of the wondrous, for it's hard not to wonder how... What did I do? I didn't do anything. Okay. It's hard not to wonder at how the iPad simulates the relationship between inertia and friction, or at how Google Glass is an invisible portal to information now embedded into our perception of the world. But it's also marvelous in the sense that these devices seem to have supernatural properties, or they want to market themselves as that, but of course, supernatural they are not. And so a lot of the work that I do, especially in the framework of media archaeology, works to demystify these devices, especially by looking at how writers demystify these devices, looking specifically at how interfaces limit and also create certain creative possibilities. Technological constraints are nothing new, which is why my book ends in the 19th century talking about Emily Dickinson's work with fascicles, little hand-sewn and hand-created booklets. But I think what is new is that the interfaces themselves nowadays, digital interfaces, and therefore their constraints, are becoming ever more difficult to perceive because of the blinding seduction of the wondrous, which at least partly comes back into view again once we undertake an excavation of how things could have been otherwise. So I think that despite our best efforts to literally and figuratively bring invisible interfaces back into view, perhaps because we're so enmeshed in this in these media, or because there's an overwhelming ideology of the user-friendly that makes it very difficult to see through, I think at best we may only partly see the shape of contemporary computing devices. Media archaeology, however, I think provides a sobering conceptual friction in the way that certain theorists identified with the field use it to undertake, and this is a quote, a hermeneutic reading of the new against the grain of the past rather than telling of the histories of technologies from past to present. On the whole, media archaeology does not seek to reveal the present as an inevitable consequence of the past, but instead looks to describe it as one possibility generated out of a heterogeneous past. Also at the heart of media archaeology, which is something that I really identify with, is an ongoing struggle to keep alive what Sigrid Zelinsky calls variantology, or this discovery of individual variations in the use or abuse of media, especially those variations that defy the ever-increasing trend towards standardization and uniformity among competing electronic and digital technologies. So following Zelinsky, a lot of the work that I've been doing recently involves uncovering a non-linear, non-teleological series of media phenomena, or ruptures, as people call it sometimes, as a way to avoid reinstating a model of media history that tends towards narratives of progress and generally ignores neglected, failed, or dead media. So this book project that I was just telling you about, Reading Writing Interfaces, it's also evidence of doing through building, curating, and tinkering in the Media Archaeology Lab here at the University of Colorado at Boulder. This is a lab that I founded in 2009 with a generous grant from Atlas, and I use it for cross-disciplinary experimental research and teaching, actively using the tools, the software, the platforms from the past. So what makes the Media Archaeology Lab so unusual is that it is not a museum of vintage computers. It is a place where everything works. We've got computers dating back from 1977, and we also have a growing collection of typewriters as well as magic lanterns and projectors. So dead media of all kinds, dead in the sense of zombie media, right? It's dead but still living. Without having the ability to directly discover what you can call the variantology of early computing, without experiencing what it's like to operate a computer which predates standardized interfaces, and whose target audience is the DIYer, the tinkerer, the curious, the entire book project would not have been possible. And I wouldn't understand, to the extent that I do now, this ideology of the user-friendly that I mentioned briefly that's produced so many of these closed, supposedly interface-free interfaces. The MAL houses most of the computers I talk about in my book, including an Apple II, an Apple Lisa, and an Apple Macintosh, and I've sort of focused on these computers in particular as really crucial computers for understanding this development towards the closed interface. The Apple II, as some of you I know, was one of the first and most popular personal computers and most affordable. It used the command line interface, and it was one of the first computers adopted by especially the writing community to create innovative works of digital literature in the early 1980s, whereas the Apple Lisa, which was the first, I would say, commercial computer to have a graphical user interface, not affordable though. You could buy it for $10,000, which is about $20,000 in 2013. And then the Apple Macintosh, which I don't have an original one, but it looks something like this, which came out a year later, and that was the first affordable graphical user interface. And so I've been using the MAL as a kind of thinking device that enables me to tinker and to track the utterly unique material specificities of these computers, their interfaces, platforms, and software all of which I think in the end makes it possible to defamiliarize or make visible for critique contemporary invisible interfaces and platforms. So I was also asked to touch on what sorts of support I'd like to see happen at CU. So this leads into my little wish list. Is that even though the MAL is absolutely intertwined with my research, as well as the research of about a half a dozen graduate students, as well as local and visiting researchers, artists, and writers, at the moment it's considered part of my service to the university. And yet everything about the lab, as I've just said, comes out of research, and it generates research for me and a small but growing community of artist students and researchers. A more pressing problem is that despite all the attention and accolades the MAL continues to get, it currently has a budget of zero. And I'm perversely proud of this because, I mean, look at this. There's so much information on this website. So the website itself, I'll just go back to the homepage, was made by a small group of incredible undergraduate students working on one of their TAM projects for Atlas last spring, made for me for free. The catalog, which is still very much in process, but it should have about 1,000 individual items in it. And this was created by graduate students as well, one of whom is sitting right there at the back, Kyle, who you should all say hi to. Kyle did an incredible job working with me this summer, along with a PhD student, Eric Eisen. You know, they come with standard English literature training, but these graduate students learned how every single one of these computers works in the lab, which is a feat in itself. They then learned what accessioning was. Then they accessioned all 1,000 items in the lab. They came up with an appropriate metadata schema to describe all of these items. They cataloged everything, they photographed everything, and put it up on the website. I also get most of my computers, software, hardware, as donations, which just comes from me haunting Craigslist and making friends with random strangers on eBay. and just sort of endless networking. But this is the thing, is that as the lab becomes more and more well-known, and as digital artists and writers start to donate their original 5 1/4 inch floppies to me from the late 70s and throughout the 80s, the lab has a growing responsibility to preserve and protect these works. And we're just absolutely not equipped to do that. We don't have the expertise, we don't have the resources. So this is a real issue for me. So again, I just want to underline that I've been tremendously fortunate to have developed this sort of grassroots community of people who are willing to help me. On campus, we have people, friends in IT throughout the libraries, art, journalism, film, and communication, people who have donated their computers, their equipment, their time, and their expertise. We also have donors from across the country who will occasionally create road trips, vacations, to come to the MAL and help us repair computers or just help us in general. So in short, I think if the MAL is going to continue to thrive and grow into one of the largest of its kind in North America, then we really have to find a way to get access to expert help and resources across campus that are often locked away from us because of various institutional boundaries that make sharing resources extremely difficult, if not impossible. And I think this kind of flexibility and interdisciplinarity would also in the end lead to a more flexible, more expansive notion of what counts as research in the humanities beyond the single authored book. That working in a lab, curating, archiving, all these activities are absolutely research. And the way that the Media Archaeology Lab crosses disciplinary boundaries, as well as the boundaries between the institution and the broader public, represents not the way digital humanities or digital media will be done in the future, but the way it's being done now. And somehow we need to figure out how to make institutional structures more nimble and more able to react and accommodate entities such as the Media Archaeology Lab. So thank you very much for your attention.